Hi everyone, I'm Sebastien. I'm an engineer at IC. IC is a self-driving company based out of Boston. Our main product is a self-driving truck that operates in logistic yards. So think of it as picking up the trailer, navigating the yard, parking, and moving on to its next container. And today, with Juan Ortega, lead DevOps at IC, we prepared a short talk about distributed simulation with Bazel. Since we only have 10 minutes, we'll mostly touch the developer experience aspect of this. And the idea is to see how a good developer experience can have a very positive impact on system safety. So you may be wondering what's DevEx and safety have to do with one another. And my objective in this talk is to convince you that those two things are not necessarily completely orthogonal. So let's talk a little bit about self-driving software. The worst of both worlds, let me explain. It's a very hard problem. We've been promised every year that self-driving cars are around the corner in the last 6 years, and I did that myself many times. The thing is, people think it's a very hard problem, mostly because of the AI nature of the problem. The car needs to be very intelligent, think about all the different problems that can arise. It turned out that there are other problems that are maybe easier to solve. Communication between engineers is actually a real problem, and DevOps as well. So why the worst of both worlds? Well, research scientists are usually very comfortable in a very flexible environment where they can try out new dependencies and basically run some experiments with, let's say, fairly lenient coding standards. On the other side, software engineers prefer usually handling systems that they can fully test A to Z, and they're not necessarily very comfortable when you have an AI-driven system where you're not only testing that the code is bug-free, but you're also testing that the intended functionality is yielding a safe behavior. So basically, both research scientists and software engineers are completely out of their comfort bubble, and that can cause a lot of frustration, and it can get fairly chaotic fairly quickly. On top of that, we're striving to get deterministic behavior, and we have to deploy the software in fairly diverse environment, ranging from the onboard deployment on the target hardware, as well as at scale on the cloud, so that we can run thousands of scenarios in parallel. So, thankfully, Bazel is here to save the day. Well, at least if we use it the right way. So what do I mean by that? What are the kind of artifacts that we're building in a self-driving system? So we're driving you're building your typical Python libraries, C++ libraries, so basically low-level artifacts. On top of that, we build actual executable binaries with your typical CC binary target or Py binary. So it could be like a trajectory planner, an obstacle detector. It's a distributed system, so you have like several of those that are meant to talk to each other. Or it could be some test code, some utilities, and so on. Then at a higher level, we start having custom targets that we call nodes. And those are basically runtime configured versions of those binary targets. So it's going to contain build information for that trajectory planner together with runtime configuration that we really want to track with Bazel as well. So those are subsystems. And on top of that, we start having system level targets. And those are targets that depend on multiple applications that are meant to run in a coordinated fashion. So this could be an integration test. So typically the same way you would test the integration of microservices, in our case you would test the behavior that emerges from two of those nodes operating with one another with some test script that is stimulating this system in some way and analyzing the output. It could also be the entire self-driving stack that you want to deploy on the hardware platform. This custom rules can also be used to create a cloud simulation where you run almost the entire system, but you leave aside the sensory nodes that are replaced with log data. And obviously you don't have the real physical trucks, you need to run a truck simulator. So those are the kind of system level targets that I want to talk about. And on the side, you also have some secondary artifacts as Docker containers and deployment manifests that we need to deploy those targets. So yeah, this is basically a summary of the build graph for us. And we're going to focus on the blue and the grid targets. All right, so let's jump into what we call orchestration rules, which are the custom rules that we put together to ease the developer experience. So this is a small example, slightly simplified to fit on the slide, where you can see we have a few custom rules and macros. The first one, application config, is basically what I described earlier, where you pick a binary executable target in the target attribute, and you associate it with the runtime configuration. Here it's a YAML file. Side note, we're starting to notice that Starlark is not only good for build configuration, but it could also be used for runtime configuration. And so we may, in the future, also migrate some of the stuff that's defined in this YAML file and use the fact that Starlark is a de facto very capable configuration language as well. So in this case, you actually have two instances of the same executable target, example app, decline into two different application configs. Then one level up, we had more at the system level, we have an orchestrator config, which is basically declaring that for this system, you want to have those three different applications running together with their runtime configuration. And finally, last target that is actually runnable, the performance metric, tracking metric, which allows you to run a test script. Here it's a Python script. And you use this previously defined system to stimulate. So this was the user interaction in the build file. Let's look at the actual CLI interaction in the terminal. So as you would expect, the first Bazel run line is actually just using the name of the target. And it basically does what you would expect it to do. So it's running a distributed simulation, running a test that is stimulating this distributed system. It creates a single container and passes the necessary runtime arguments to those applications to basically initialize them, wait for them to be ready, and then run the actual test. At the end, it writes on disk the result of the analysis. So fairly straightforward, but already fairly convenient to use because a lot of things are happening under the hood and you can just run it with a single Bazel command, which is nice. As a side note, there is no hidden shell script in the loop because that's how sometimes when you run multiple targets, you're tempted to add like a very ugly shell script and we try not to do that. The second one gets a little bit more interesting. You're just adding the .cloud suffix. And basically, you get the exact same experiment, but it's running on the cloud, on public cloud infrastructure. So it's very similar in terms of experience. But what's happening is under the hood is different. So In this case, we actually have a different containerization strategy where every application is packaged separately so that we can run them on very cheap cloud instances. Then we pass different runtime configuration arguments to those applications to tell them that, all right, you're not running on the same machine anymore, so you can't use shared memory communication, for example, and you'll have to use TCP-based communication to talk to the other nodes. And this is basically auto-generated for you. Same for the Kubernetes deployment manifest. And as I was saying earlier, we want to make all the stakeholders of the self-driving industry happy. So we also want to pack some features for example, data scientists or research scientists. So the third one shows how we can make that happen with Bazel. So here we have a third runnable target, .notebook, which is actually not running the test. It's opening a web browser, and it's running in the background a Jupyter notebook server with a preloaded test file that is the same test file. But you can actually manually interact with the different nodes and shut them down, turn them back on, and potentially debug a problem or quickly iterate on your system. So yeah, that's basically our vision when it comes to making Bazel improve the developer experience for all the different stakeholders. So let's just recap and see why this can have a very nice impact on software safety. So as we said earlier, self-driving system, an AI-driven self-driving system, is actually not easy to validate. Actually, there is no theory at the moment that allows you to formally prove that a self-driving system is safe. So everything you can do to foster the creation of integration tests that are going to improve the coverage of this high-dimensional set of behaviors that can emerge is good. And as a DevOps engineer or as a member of the build team, you can actually shape that interface, that developer interface, to promote this kind of test for being created. So basically, engineering culture in the self-driving industry is an essential part of the final product safety. That's something we've noticed. And this can be made much better using a better developer experience. And Bazel is a great tool for that. Additionally, having this developer interface allows you to pack additional tooling. So you saw there was this .cloud and .notebook. You could think of adding a .profiler target as well, which would wrap all those application calls with a non-intrusive profiler and generate a latency report or like a performance report, which is a much nicer entry point to latency profiling than having to run like Linux perf on one of those targets, for example. So conclusion, is this tempting to only use Bazel to solve our problems, which are usually build efficiency, dependency management, in some cases developer velocity, but we should also use it as a weapon to really shape the behavior of our users, you know, in this case, research scientists, and software engineers and all the people that actually don't fit into one of those boxes. And we should really use Bazel to basically improve their developer experience. And finally, really think of the rules you're creating as a developer interface that will help you later on disseminate some improvement and some additional tooling and have a greater impact on the entire team. So this is the end of my talk. I'd like to thank Juan, Honza, and Michel, without which this vision would really not have been possible. And if you have some questions, and if this is something that's interesting for you, you can reach out to me on the Bazel Slack. Thank you.